All right, good morning.
Good morning.
All right, it is possible that on entering this church, you may hear the call of God. On the other hand, it is not likely that he will contact you by phone. So we thank you for turning off your phone. And if you would like to talk to God, come in, choose a quiet place, and talk to him. If you would like to see him, send him a text while you're driving. I'm so sorry that Reverend Mark is not here today, because this was actually found in a French church. I'm going to talk a little bit today about David and Goliath. This is a story that I loved from the Bible when I was a kid. And this comes from Samuel in 1 Samuel in the Old Testament. So Goliath is this great big Philistine warrior. And the Philistines are the enemy of Israel. And so this Goliath, this giant of a man, of a warrior, challenges the army of Israel to come fight him. You know, and so what they used to do, and apparently this was not uncommon, is they would say, you send your best guy, we'll send our best guy, we'll duke it out, there'll be a lot less bloodshed. And it's an interesting idea. So when Goliath comes on the scene, pretty much everybody flees in fear. He is just enormous, and he's an experienced soldier. He has a spear, he has a sword, he has a helmet, he has armor, he has a shield. He would be a terrifying sight. And so nobody wants to fight him. And there is a young shepherd boy, David. He's really just a kid. If you came on the trip to Italy with us a few years back, we saw Michelangelo's David, and that statue of David, so everybody can imagine that right now probably, that big statue of David is a young boy standing there, and he's getting ready to throw that stone. So David's a young shepherd boy. He has no armor. Basically what he has is he has a shepherd's staff, and he has a sling, and he picks up 5 smooth stones. But what David has, and I think this is the what the 5 stones really are for me, is that David has God. So the king, Saul, decides that he will send David into battle. So David opposes Goliath. And when Goliath sees him, he sees this young shepherd boy with a staff, he taunts David. And now David has this sling. Right? And so don't think like a slingshot. It wasn't like that kind of a sling. That what they had is this long sling with like these 2 straps of leather, and they would get this stone going in the sling and then let one end of the sling go. And they got very, very good at being accurate with this sling. And so I heard someone say that they got that sling going so fast, it was faster than an American League pitcher. Yeah, so they pitch about 90 miles an hour. So that's pretty fast to get a sling going. He lets go of one end of the sling, and, I'll finish the story. So David opposes Goliath. Goliath laughs. The giant taunts David. David puts a stone in the sling, and he hits Goliath with the very first stone right between the eyes. Right? Now, David says, I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts. So I would ask us to think about now, what's Goliath in your life? It might be a habit you have. It might be some particular condition. It might be a situation that you've been working at changing and you've just not been able to change. You know, one of the things I love about the science of mind, when I teach the foundation classes, people come in new and they start to work with these principles, and very often, very quickly, they have big demonstrations and they have really big healings. And it's really, really exciting. And I think there's a reason why. Because what we say in class is when you start to put new into your mind and into your spiritual practice, and you do this with some consistency, you're putting new in, eventually you're going to start to get some new results out here in the world. So David comes to Goliath in the name of the Lord. And I think we all have Goliaths in our life. But what we do is that we seem to make Goliath bigger than God rather than make our God bigger than Goliath. You know, and so Am I trying to defeat something with a sword, a spear, a shield, an armor, helmet? These are all things of the material world. Now, I know God works through all of it, but I think it's important to remember that God is the power that's operating through all of it. So maybe I need to cultivate my faith to be victorious like David. You know, I turn to God because, you know, what we believe is that with God, all things are possible. With God, all things are possible. Scriptures don't say without God, all things are possible, right? It's with God, all things are possible. And so, like David says, you know, he will deliver me. He will help me overcome. So now, the thing that I really latched on this time into the story is that David, when he's talking to King Saul, trying to convince Saul to send him, he says, look, God was with me, and God helped me overtake a lion when a lion was threatening me and my sheep. And then God was with me, and God helped me overtake a bear when a bear was threatening me and my sheep. So surely God will be with me when I go up against Goliath. So if you would look at your own life, you will probably see there are lots of instances where you had situations that looked very, very challenging and like you maybe even thought, I will never get through this. And yet you did. And that has happened for all of us again and again and again in our life. Again, pointing to the scripture that with God, all things are possible. So I was thinking about these stones that David picks up. Now, if I were writing the story today, I would say David picks up 7 stones as opposed to 5 stones, but who knows anyway? I think he got a handful of stones. And so those stones, to me, represent the spiritual practices we teach to transform our consciousness. Now, Ernest Holmes says there is no real transformation without an ongoing practice of prayer and meditation, and those are the first 2 stones. You know, that the way you carry God with you into all situations at all times is that you have an ongoing practice where you pray every day. Now, I don't mean like just the Lord's Prayer, like we said. You can say all kinds of other prayers. I like the prayer of St. Francis. But Ernest Holmes, I believe, was also talking about treatment, spiritual mind treatment, where we set the law in motion again and again and again. And we have to do this every day. So often people come to me and they talk about how they really start to pray when things are difficult. Well, I think that's better than not praying when things are difficult. I really do. But really, the truth is, if you're practicing this teaching, you would be praying all along. And I think that one of the things that you would find is you experience less difficulties because you have an ongoing practice of prayer. So one of the stones is we have to pray every day, multiple times a day. The second one is that we have to meditate. You know, Mother Teresa said that God is a friend of silence. Right? So we all want to hear the voice of God. We want God to speak to us, to give us clear direction, to show me the right thing to do, God. Just show me. Show me in a way I understand. You know how thick I am. Right? And so what that means to me is that means I have to be quiet. I have to be really, really quiet. So we're going to pray. We're going to meditate. We've got to study. Study the science of mind or the Bible if it speaks to you or any other truth teaching that has withstood the test of time. You know, because you know if it's withstood the test of time, that it really does contain truth, and that will feed your soul. We have to be open to new ideas and ahas and revelations. Pray, study. We said meditate, serve. I think it's essential. Everybody's life gets better when they find an avenue to be of service. I think any real spiritual tradition on the face of the planet will tell you that part of how your life has sanity and how you get healed as you find some avenue to be of service. And we're not saying what that needs to look like, but you know what I mean. Some place where you are of service because that's really where your life comes from. And to tithe. I would say that 5th stone in David's little bag of stones is tithing. You know, that we teach that tithing is an act of gratitude to God for all that God continues to give to us. Now, I'm going to add 2 stones to David's arsenal here that I think are essential for our personal transformation and spiritual growth. And I would say one of those things is an ongoing practice of forgiveness. It's essential. You know, forgiveness is not something we do once in a lifetime and then we don't have to think about it again. Forgiveness is something we visit again and again and again, not only every day, but sometimes multiple times throughout the day. Forgiveness is a process. It's not a one-time thing. And I think we've really done ourselves a disservice by letting ourselves think, well, if I really forgave, you know, I'd say something one time, like, I forgive you, and then it would never even enter into my mind again. Well, I don't know anybody that's ever happened for, do you? I mean, I think it's something that we visit again and again and again, and it's like that idea of peeling off the layers of an onion. I think every time we do it, we're making progress, but it shows you how deep things go that they don't happen just like that sometimes. So I would say that sixth stone is forgiveness, and that's something we need to carry in our spiritual arsenal every day. And I think the seventh stone is gratitude. You know, gratitude is the anointing of increase. And one of the easiest things we can do if we want our life to get better is to practice gratitude on a daily, daily basis. It's not that hard. It doesn't cost anything. And we think, you know, I think if we charged people to practice gratitude, they would do more of it. You know, because they think, well, he charges a lot for it, so it must be really valuable. I better do it, you know. But because it's free, I think people discredit it. They think this couldn't really, really make a difference. But you know, it says in the Bible that to a grateful heart, much is given. To a grateful heart, much is given. And I believe the way it works is that when we are grateful, the universe is always giving us more to be grateful for. That's principled. You know, that gratitude is the anointing of increase. When you're grateful, it's like you're telling God, I'm a really grateful customer in the universe, and the universe says, well, he's such a grateful customer, let's give him more to be happy about. It seems like a really reasonable practice to me. You know, like, why wouldn't I do that? It's free. It's not even cheap, it's free. My gosh. So we are talking about that David's arsenal against what looks insurmountable. And I know we all have things in our life at different times that look insurmountable. We could be facing a big challenge in a relationship. We could be facing a big challenge with our health or around our finances or a job coming to an end or we need to move or this or that. It could be any of those things. And so again, we come back to that scripture that with God, all things are possible. Doing it by myself, I will only have so much success. You know, because at some point, my energy and my enthusiasm is going to run out. At some point, I'm going to hit obstacles and I'm going to give up. But all of these practices, this is why I love the science of mind. Ernest Holmes, in his development of the science of mind teaching, was an enormously practical person. He said, and he wrote about that, if a religion didn't make your life better, why did you practice that religion? If it didn't, if he didn't give, you know, so his thing was to give us tools that would actually, you know, that we would actually do and would make our life better. How they make our life better is they change our consciousness from the inside out. So the science of mind is not a course in changing things out here. The science of mind is actually a program, is a method, a way of thinking and a philosophy of changing things in here. And what we teach is as things change in here and we keep them changed, we are bound to see tremendous things happen in the outer world, out in our life. So this week I have a little assignment for you that I want you to think about what is it that you absolutely do not want to bring in to 2020. Think about that. Now, I don't mean your old sofa or your recliner, you know. But I want you to think about what you really don't want to. You know, I don't want to grouse about my brother anymore. I don't want to fight with that neighbor whose trash is always in my yard. You know, whatever that is, you know, I don't want to struggle with finances for one more year. I don't want to be complaining about this health condition one more year. Whatever that is, I want you to bring that mentally next week. So again, no sofas, no recliners. Okay, I don't have a place for them. And what we're going to do after each service is we're going to have like a little burning bowl ceremony. We're going to burn all that we are not taking with us next week. So I will give you the special paper to write it on. And since we do not have a big fire pit at church, but we have a grill, we will build, it's a modern time, you know, we don't have to do it in the old way. We will have a little fire in the grill and you will leave feeling incredibly, incredibly free. So that's the homework for this week. And I believe for each and every one of us, we will go into the new year like David, not afraid of our Goliath. Let's pray. So as we turn our attention inward now, we take a moment to just reflect on the spiritual truth that God is right where we are, and that one with God is the majority. So not only are we one with God on the unseen side of life, we are all connected with each other in the mind and in the heart of God. So in this awareness of our connection, I speak the word for each and every one of us, and I know that great healing is at hand for us, that we are designing, we are co-creating our future with God right now in this moment. And in the week ahead, we become keenly aware of what we choose to not bring forward into a new decade. So I claim for each and every one of us this week, we have perfect clarity, and that healing is taking place in our life on every level, spiritually, mentally, emotionally, physically. We are open to the infinite good of God expressing in our lives. And we do the practices to support this. So we include in our prayer our family members and friends, our parents and children, all of those we love and hold near and dear. We see them in our mind's eye. We wrap our spiritual arms around them, and we know that right where they are, God is in its fullness. That God, our Father, Mother, the source of intelligence and love and creativity and fulfillment, is present not only in the lives of those we love, but in the world in which we live. So all of those situations that pull at our attention, God, infinite, loving, intelligent spirit, is right there, even in the midst of that, waiting to be revealed. And so we call it forward now in loving ways. We bless our church. We bless all churches. We bless synagogues and temples and mosques and ashrams, all paths to God. And I'm certain that we are blessed by being together today, that there is an upliftment in consciousness. And so with an open, gracious, full heart, I give thanks that this is the truth. I give thanks in advance for perfect healing. And I release this word, and so it is. Together we all say, Amen.